Father, you are so good. You're so gracious. You're so faithful. You're always on time. Not our time, but your time. And we just want to tell you this morning that we love you. We thank you for loving us when we weren't lovable. And still there are times when we're not, but your love towards us never changes. For that we're grateful. Pray that what we do today would be pleasing to you, that we'll do our best to put a smile on your face. And when we finish this day, we say our last amen, then you've been pleased with what we've done. In Christ's name, amen. Visitors, I'm sorry. Come in, guys. All right, we got new help today. We got one with a full head of hair. I just hate people that's got hair like that. What?
We're in training.
Yeah. Anybody here today for the very first time? Anybody at all? Raise your hand. Guys, we got to get some visitors in. Where's one at over here? All right. Hey, man, good to have you today. Thank you for being with us. I like your pink shirt. That's nice. Good job. There is a pen in there, and there's a visitor's card. And if you don't mind, if you'll fill it out and drop it in the offering plate in a few minutes, we would appreciate it so much. But again, thank you for being with us.
As I journeyed through this land, singing as I go, pointing souls to Calvary, through the crimson flow. Without and within, but my Lord leads me on.
Sing it, girl.
And through Him, yeah. I must win.
Oh, I want to see Him look upon His face.
Service for my Lord, dark may be the night, but I'll cling more close to Him, and He will give me light. Satan's snares may vex my soul, turn my thoughts aside. Oh, but my Lord, He goes ahead, leads whatever betide.
Oh, I want to see look upon His face, there to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice.
When before me billows rise from the mighty deep, then the Lord directs my mind, He doth safely keep.
And He leads me gently on through this world below. You see, He's a real friend to me. Oh, I love Him so. Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face, and to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Here's all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. Here's all past,
we're gonna be home at last, ever to rejoice.
Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face, let's sing forever of His saving. We're gonna be home at last. Ever to rejoice.
Amen. Stand with us. We continue to sing. This song says, our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. There's never been a truer statement said. You sing it with us this morning.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest way, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, oh, mother ground in sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Sing the last.
When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found. Rest in his righteousness alone, all blessed to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
You know, I really believe in all of our lives there's times that we have regrets. We wish we had done something different. We wish that we had said something different. Maybe when we lose a loved one, we say something like, boy, I wish I had told them more that I love them, or I wish I'd have done something, whatever it may be. And I hope that when we see the Lord Jesus Christ, when we see him face to face, and when we see heaven and all that's incorporated and all that, that we'll probably say something like, I wish I'd have praised him more. I don't mean acting stupid. Somebody began sending me on my phone recordings of Pentecostal churches where, and I'm not being critical of Pentecostal. If you've got loved ones, that's great. But they're out dancing. Some of them are laying in the floor, flopping around like a fish out of water and such as that. But, you know, I just think whatever your way of praising God, that's what you ought to do. God tells you to put your hand like this. Help yourself. Knock yourself out. Okay? If God tells you to raise your hands and praise him, don't worry about what somebody else is going to say. It doesn't matter. We got a young man visiting here with a pink shirt. If we brought snakes out, don't worry about it. It's okay. We don't have a one, young man. I promise you there's not a snake in this house. You know, unless they're standing on 2 feet, we don't have one snake whatsoever. But I just don't think I can never praise him enough for what he's done for me. Never. I remember reading the story, and I'll shut up in a minute. I remember reading the story of a lady died. She was way up in years. She and her husband had been married for, I don't know, like 60 or 70 years, just precious. They were talking about how he walked up to the casket and looked down in her, and he just started saying things like, I just want to thank you for getting up early and making all them biscuits for me all these years. And he just went through all this that she had done. Thank you for ironing my shirts, baby. You were so good. Thank you for all the patience. You know, and tears dropping off of his cheek and such as that. And I thought, if he could say that to his love of his life, laying there like that, why can't we say something like that or do whatever we need to do for the one that died for us? I've never had anybody die for me other than soldiers that gave their life on the field. But he died for me when he didn't have to. So as you sing that, you think about, Lord, I can never praise you enough. Here we go.
I could never praise you enough for the cross of Calvary. I could never thank him enough for salvation, Lord.
I'll serve you. I will serve thee because I love thee.
Yeah.
And that's the only thing that keeps us going in what we do. I don't do what I do at this church because I'm crazy about you. I don't take that personal, okay? I really don't. I do what I do at this church. I do what I do for that woman right there because I love him and I want to serve him. And that's what the book says that I'm supposed to do. I will serve thee because I love thee. And I think that's so important in our life. Here we go.
I will serve thee because I love thee. You have given life to me. I was nothing before you found me.
Have you ever had one of those days at work or just in life where you said something like this, "Good night, will this day ever end?" Anybody ever had one of those days? Yeah, I thought so. I've had a few of those. Did you know that one day that's going to come true? You will be, if you know Christ as Savior, you'll be in a place where that day will never end. That place is called heaven. And have you ever given thought to this? What are you going to do your first day there? It's only going to be one day, but it's going to be an eternal day. It's going to last forever. Now, I think personally, most of us are going to spend most of our time doing what the Bible talks about. We'll be at the feet of Jesus, praising Him, thanking Him for what He's done for us. But at some point, you're going to get to go enjoy what He's there creating for us right now. The Bible talks about a mansion that we can't fathom, streets of pure gold, the crystal sea. I'm looking forward to that. You know why I'm looking forward to the crystal sea, don't you? Yeah. Yeah, it's going to be full of fish. They're all going to be trophies. But as we sing this song, I want you to sit there and I want you to think about what you're going to do the first day in heaven. I know for a lot of us, we're going to spend time looking for some that are already there ahead of us. Spending time with them, time that we've missed being with them while here on this earth. That's going to be, I can't fathom how great that's going to be. But as we sing this song, you listen, it says the first day of forever.
The day is getting closer, the time is drawing near. I feel it in my spirit, I'll soon be leaving here, and in my mind just imagine forever with my Lord. The first day of forever, what a day that will be. The first day of forever.
Gather over there, but there is no reunion that will ever quite compare to that wondrous moment when I'll stand before His throne. Voice of Jesus say, my child will come home.
The first day of forever, oh what a day that will be. The first day the one who died.
good, good too.
I will sit down by the river and with rapture old acquaintance renew.
Choir be dismissed and our ushers come in and take today's offering. Oh, how I love Jesus. You know, this song is one of those dumb moments. We ought to love him. He loved us in spite of us. Christ has never had a fault. I have, though. He loves me in spite of my faults. And he died for me, like we've already talked about. So we ought to be able to sing this song this morning from our heart. You sing it with us.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. It tells of one whose loving heart can feel my deepest woe, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus.
Women have taken over. How y'all doing this morning? Ella Kate, you doing well? Yeah, y'all look good this morning. Are you doing okay? Do you know what you're doing? You sure? You know exactly what you're doing, don't you? Okay. We're ready to pray. You ready to pray? Let's pray. Jesus, thank you, Lord, for your blessings. Thank you for being so good for so long in so many ways. Thank you for these precious babies. I pray you bless them. I pray your protection in their lives and all that they do. Thank you for parents that love you enough and love them enough to put y'all two together at this place. For that, we're grateful. In Christ's name, amen. Lord, we ask you to meet the needs of our church, and you do. We want to sure slow down long enough to thank you for the offering today. Thank you for your faithfulness. In Christ's name, amen.
Tracy's going to come and sing a beautiful, beautiful old song for us this morning. A song that's entitled, Consider the Lilies. You listen to the words of this song.
Thank you.
Consider the lilies, they don't toil nor spin, and there's not a king with more splendor than them. Consider the sparrows, they don't plant nor sow, they're fed by the Master who watches them grow. We have a Heavenly Father above, with eyes full of mercy and a heart full of love. He really cares when your head is bowed low. Consider the lilies, and then you will know. May I introduce to this friend of mine who hangs at the stars, tells the sun when to shine, and kisses the flowers each morning with dew. But he's not too busy to care about you. We have a Heavenly Father above, with eyes full of mercy and a heart full of love. He consider the lilies, and then you will know. Consider the lilies, and then you will.
Thank you so much. If we had the capacity in our lives in some way or the other to be able to look around today and look at the person in front of us, or maybe the person beside us, and we don't know them. Maybe we do. Maybe they're kin. Maybe they're just a visitor or whatever it may be. We don't always know what's going on in their lives. We don't know what they're facing in their life. We don't know what they have gone through the last few days. My time in the ministry, I have pastored people that would come to church just to get away from an abusive husband. I'm not saying that was the only reason they came to church, but I knew that when they came, that they were they felt a relief simply because of that. And I'm not saying you have that. I'm just saying we don't know. We don't always understand what folk are going through. We don't always understand what they're having to deal with. And sometimes we are more than blessed because of God's grace and goodness to us in our lives in a lot of different ways. There may be those in here today that are dealing with a physical. Maybe they got a call from a doctor this week, and it wasn't necessarily the kind of report they wanted to get. Maybe their job situation is a bit uncertain. the list could go on with the things that we sometimes face in our life. And I'm saying all that to simply say this, of how important it is in our lives to know and understand and enjoy the grace of God as we go through these times in our lives. God's grace. We not only need God's saving grace. You know, when we get saved, the Bible says, for by grace are you saved through faith. So we're saved by the grace of God. But we also need living grace. We need every day of our life, we need the grace of God to be real in our lives to get through whatever that circumstance or whatever that situation may be in our lives in order to get through it. I've known people that need dying grace. That they were knew that there was no hope. They knew that they were at that time in their life that they needed that grace in their life at that particular time. I don't know what you might be going through right now in your life. I don't know what you may be facing. And maybe you don't know. Maybe you don't know what's around the corner. Maybe you don't know if you're going to get that phone call this week. But at least you can go back and try to remember. You know, I remember the preacher talked about the grace that I need for times like this. So I want you to take your Bible. I want to look for just a minute. If you go to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. I'm again reading with verse number 7. Paul was talking about the grace of God in his life. And Paul was well aware, as the title of the message says, grace changed everything. And all that Paul was going through, and nobody faced more in their Christian life, I think, other than Christ, than Paul, the Apostle Paul, and all that he dealt with. But the grace that Paul's talking about here is a grace that God brought into his life because of some choices that Paul was making in his life. You know, even somebody like Paul had to be careful they didn't get full of themselves. There are those that do that. There are a lot of preachers that oftentimes will get full of themselves. They think that Christianity can't go on without them. But it can, I promise you. But there are those that go through a lot of different things. But Paul was in a peculiar situation, and I'll be real honest with you, in my studying for this particular message, God gave me a different understanding of what the thorn in the flesh was. Now, and I may be wrong. You know, I'm not saying everything I preach up here is right, because I'm still a work in progress, but I looked at it a little bit different. In the past, I always looked at the thorn in the flesh in Paul's life is a physical issue. Maybe a lot of people thought that Paul had an eye issue, couldn't see well. Maybe it was something else along the physical line. But I'll give you what I think, simply because of some things I studied this week. But you follow along with me, then we'll pray and we'll consider a few things. Paul said in verse 7, chapter 12, unless I should be exalted above measure. If you want to underline that word exalted, it literally means conceited. He's simply saying, at least I am conceited about who I am and about what I've done or what God's done in my life. Unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. Now, where did it come from? The messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. There's that word again, exalted. God brought this into Paul's life because of his conceit, or possibility of his conceit. For this thing I besought the Lord three times, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, if you'll notice, if you got a red lettered edition Bible, it's in red. This is what he said. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. That word perfect there means to be complete, to be finished. In other words, to grow. Paul was, you know, God was looking to grow Paul, even though he was a great preacher. For my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. In other words, Paul's saying, I'd rather go through what I'm going through and deal with what I'm dealing with than not to have the power of God upon my life. Verse 10, therefore, or because of that, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then I'm strong. Father, I ask, Lord, that you'll enable me to help people to understand that grace changes things, that what they're dealing with this week or what they may deal with next week or what they might deal with sometime in their life, that the grace of God is available and can make a difference as they go through and help them to be Christ-like in all that they face. But Lord, my prayer most of all is that people know the saving grace of Jesus Christ to save them from the pits of hell. I'll thank you for what you'll do in Christ's name. Amen and amen. I read one time that God can take a mess in our life and he can turn it into a message. He can turn a test into a testimony. You and I can be going through a test in our life, a difficult test, whatever it might be, and he can turn that into a great testimony before others. He can turn a trial into triumphant, and he can turn a victim into victory. But there's one common denominator in all of those issues in order for God to take a mess into a message and so on and so forth. For that to take place, it takes the grace of God. Now, I want to give you, and I've done this before, I want to give you a definition of grace. You should be able to see it on the screen. One of the best definitions that I come across, and I came across it from Dr. Charles Stanley. This is his definition of grace. Is God's kindness towards humanity without regard to the worth or merit of those who receive it and without them deserving it. Leave that up there for just a minute in case people... That's why you got those blank pages in the flyleaf of your Bible. Write stuff like that down. God's kindness towards humanity without regard to the worth or the merit of those who receive it and without their deserving it. Wonderful definition of grace. Now, in our text in 2 Corinthians... If you go back to, if you look at chapter 9 and verse number 8, notice what he says. Go back, 2 Corinthians 9:8. And God is able to make all grace towards you, that you always have an all sufficiency in all things, may abound unto every good work. Notice how he keeps back all things, everything you need. Look at it again, 2 Corinthians 9:8. God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that ye always, having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. The context for this verse 8 there in chapter 9, is about our giving. Okay, I understand it. I'm not trying to teach something backwards. I understand Paul is talking about in chapter 8 and 9, he's talking about the giving that takes place in the church, our tithes and offerings and so on and so forth. But what I want to do, I want you to understand in principle what Paul is saying in practicality. I want you to apply the principle that he's using. If you'll notice, the emphasis in verse number 8 of chapter 9 is the emphasis is on God is able. And the phrase all grace speaks of the natural ability that God gives a believer, no matter what the circumstances may be in your life. No matter what you're dealing with this morning, no matter what you have dealt with in the past and you're going through it and you got memory of it or maybe it was a bad marriage, maybe it was a bad decision that you made, whatever the circumstance may be. God is able, wow, how? With all grace, about to get us through whatever it is that we go through. God's resources are more than sufficient, even when we need this great grace of God, no matter what it is that we face. In other words, Paul is saying we have what we need to face whatever it is that we may face because of the grace of God. Now, as believers, we're always in need of God's grace. I can't tell you the number of times that I've done funerals, and they'll ask me normally at the beginning of a before we take the body into the chapel of a funeral home or whatever it may be, they'll ask me to open in prayer or say a prayer for the family. And without fail, I always ask for God's grace in the life of that family, that God's grace would be real to them, because they are at a time right now in their life where they've never been before. And they need this kind of grace in their life, and God is able to give that grace. But, you know, we not only need dying grace, we also need grace for the journey of life as we go through this thing called life. God's grace is not only sufficient enough to get us through the journey of life, but it also takes us through the abundant times of life, the victorious times of life, and being careful and mindful that we don't get full of ourselves. And that's exactly what Paul is saying there in chapter number 12. That's the reason that God gave him to write what it was that he wrote. Now, if you go back, and I didn't take time to go back and begin reading with verse number 1 through verse number 10, it's a page from Paul's autobiography where he testifies to the way in which he had proved the grace of God. Now, what I want to do is let's consider the faithfulness of God's grace in Paul's life, and I think also in the life of every believer. The faithfulness of God's grace in your life today, in what you're facing and what you're dealing with. Now, you may sit there and say, well, preacher, right now the water is smooth. Right now, things are great. I just got through a storm, but right now the water is smooth. Hang on, okay? The storm will begin to blow in again. That's just the way it is in the life of a believer. So let's talk about, for just a minute, about Paul and his experience with the grace of God. First of all, you see the suffering Paul experienced. You'll notice, first of all people suffer times of trials and struggles. I mean, that's just part of being a part of the human race. Believers, unbelievers, it really doesn't make any difference. We all are going to go through those seasons in our life. Matter of fact, the book of Job says this, yet man is born unto trouble as the sparks fly upward. We're all going to face our times and seasons of trouble. But it's also, in particular, it's a common experience for Christians. Listen again what the Bible says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 29. For unto you it is given in behalf of Christ not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. In our lives as Christians, as you and I decide to take a stand for God and live for God and serve God without hesitation, without reservation, we're going to suffer. And God said, the Bible says, God gives us the grace in order to deal with what we go through in life. And I want you to notice Paul's sufferings or the trials. If you'll notice, first of all, in verse 7, he talks about the thorn in the flesh. And I want to zero in for just a minute on this thorn in the flesh. I believe, after studying this thing, after realizing, if you look at, again, at verse 7, and lest I should be exalted or conceited above measure through the abundance of the revelations, that means the word that God had given me, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan. Now, the word messenger there means angel. Okay? And the angel, when you talk about an angel of Satan, you're talking about a demon, demonic angel. There's good angels and there's bad angels. And this demonized person that Paul was having to deal with was probably one of the individuals. If you remember the context of 2 Corinthians, Paul is having to defend his apostleship to the church at Corinth. Okay? There was a group inside the church that had come in and were trying to undermine his apostleship, trying to undermine everything about him. Paul, I believe, now I think Paul was talking about that this messenger of Satan was one of the key leaders that was trying to undermine his message that was going to the people there at Corinth. Now, maybe you have, in your life, you have a thorn in the flesh. Now, your thorn in the flesh may be physical. It could be anything. The things that I've spoken about just a second ago, it could be a financial issue, it could be a marital issue, it could be a person that you work with that's just driving you absolutely bonkers. Somebody's driving you crazy, and you don't know what in the world you're going to do. There's a reason that God's allowed this to take place. Paul was facing something the similar way. Now, let's learn from Paul's thorn in the flesh, okay? How it come about. First of all, I want you to notice the nature of it. It was real, and it was not imaginary. In other words, it wasn't some sort of a reoccurring fleshly desire that Paul had. Otherwise, Paul would not have gloried in it that he made mention of there in verse number 9. If you'll notice, he says, in verse number 7, speaks of it being exalted, meaning conceited. Why would Paul be conceited? Because of all the revelation that God had entrusted to him. If you go back and read the first few verses of chapter 12, you'll see and understand how God took Paul, I believe, God took Paul to heaven when he died. If y'all remember that he was stoned outside of Lystra a number of years prior to that. And God, I believe God took Paul to heaven and showed him some things. And Paul came back, and maybe there was a chance that Paul was getting full of himself. I just don't think that it was a physical issue. And here's why. This thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan, buffeted me. If God allows Paul to be humbled, I'm confident that he'll work in my life, in your life, also to humble us. God will allow things in our lives, people in our lives, circumstances in our life, situations in our lives, in order to keep us humble. People will get believers away from serving God and loving God quicker than anybody. Let me say that again. You may be facing a circumstance in your life, whatever it may be. Maybe it's a financial situation, or maybe it's a marital. I found this to be true as a pastor, that honoring people, and I don't really know how to define honoring. Some of y'all could raise your hand and say, I know what it means. But honoring people are people that call themselves Christians that can discourage an individual that loves God quicker than anything else. An honoring individual can discourage you quicker than a circumstance you find yourself in. An honoring individual that thinks they have all the answers when they don't even know the questions, think they have all the answers, can discourage people quicker than anything else. And I think that's one of the things that Paul was talking about there. Honoring people, people that discourage others, are bad about telling lies about others. You ever been lied about? Anybody ever told a half-truth about you? Let me give you a good illustration of a half-truth. Well, I don't know if there's anything to this or not, but I saw a preacher and Tammy going down the road the other day in a car. I'm not going to say anything about it. I'm just stating the fact. I saw preacher and Tammy going down the road. Now, they didn't say that the preacher was in the back seat and Danny was driving in the front along with Tammy sitting next to him. They told a half-truth. You ever had anybody tell a half-truth about you? Yeah. Well, Satan's always got somebody that's willing to not only tell a half-truth, but Satan's always got somebody that's willing to listen to a half-truth. That's the reason we need to apply the promises that he gives us in verse number 9 to our situation, to know the grace of God. So there's a nature of it. Then next, secondly, there's a purpose of it. In other words, when unpleasant things happen to us, we naturally ask, why did God permit this? Why is this going on in my life? I love God. I serve God. I'm faithful to God. Why is God allowing this to come into my life? And Paul's answer is in verse number 7. Sometimes, whether we recognize it or understand it or even accept it, pride will slip into our lives. We feel like that we've arrived, or conceit, whatever you want to call it. And no doubt Paul was very gifted spiritually speaking. That's why Paul talks about all that took place in verses 3 through 6. Paul was, if you remember, Paul was stoned to death, I believe, to death outside the city of Lystra. And maybe it was Paul was getting too much full of himself, of who he was or who he thought he was. And God had this way of humbling him. So there's the nature of it, there is the purpose of it, and then there's a source of it. Again, in verse number 7, it says that it was a messenger of Satan. But I want you to notice the word given, G-I-V-E-N, okay? The thorn was given, it was a gift given to him. Now, I'm sure Paul didn't realize and didn't think about it being a gift at that particular time. But again, in Philippians chapter 1 and verse number 29, listen to what he said. For unto you it is given in behalf of Christ not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. Paul had a thorn in the flesh. God had given him this thorn in the flesh in order to get him humbled in his life. There are times in your life, in my life, God will give us things that we don't necessarily want. God will give us gifts that we don't necessarily recognize sometimes. But thorns are given to us by the Lord, and they're delivered oftentimes by Satan. Let me tell you something, guys. You and I need to understand and never forget, Satan is still under the thumb of God Almighty. Satan can't do just all that Satan wants to do, okay? There's going to come a day that God will deal with Satan, but God still got Satan under his thumb. God's God. God can do whatever God wants to do. But God allows certain things to take place that he might grow us. You learn that in the book of Job. If you look at the life of Job, God allowed certain things to take place. And then there's not only the nature and the purpose and the source, there's a result of it. Look at the result found in verse 8. He says, for the thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. Now, it drove Paul to prayer. I don't know what you might be dealing with. I don't know what your thorn in the flesh may be. But I want to encourage you to allow whatever it is to drive you to your knees, that God will permit you to pray and seek his face during these times. So, number one, there's a suffering that Paul experienced. Number two, the supplication that Paul made, how we should respond. You say, excuse me, preacher, what does supplication mean? Well, let me put it like this. I have, and I think I've told, maybe it's a Wednesday night crowd this before, when we're talking about prayer time at church. I have, in my prayer time, I have a certain formula that I follow, so to speak, so I can try to keep on schedule as far as prayer. And I use I use the word Acts, A-C-T-S, like the book of Acts, okay? I use the word Acts as a guide for me as I pray. And what I mean by that is simply this. First of all, I go to the letter A, adoration. I begin to adore Christ for a while. I begin to tell him how much I love him. I begin to tell him how good he is for me. I begin to tell him how gracious and how faithful he's been. I just adore him. You know, just you ladies, You know, after somebody picked you up, when your husband started adoring you a whole lot, you know, you'd understand what adoration means. If I came in and my wife and I started adoring her, if I started saying all these wonderful things about her and bragging on her and just going through the regiment, boy, you know, after I picked her up off the floor, because she's going to pass out from me saying it, but she would be thrilled that there was adoration, okay? So in my time of supplication, I go through acts. Acts, adoration. A-C, confession. This may take some of y'all a little bit longer, okay? Confession of what? Confession of sin. We're all going to sin. We're all going to mess up through the day, through the week, or whatever it may be. So don't sit there and say, I don't know what you're talking about. We're all going to mess up, okay? Lord, forgive me for having such an angry thought towards Danny Farmer. I am so sorry. Lord, I didn't mean to think that way towards that silly shirt he wore church Sunday. I didn't mean. Now, I'm just making stuff up, so don't y'all walk out here and say, or the pink shirt. Man, I like the pink shirt. You know, if I say that enough, I'm hoping he'll hand it down. But no. But you know, we all have things to confess. So there's A, adoration. C, confession. T, thanksgiving. Lord, thank you for being so good to me. Thank you for meeting needs in my life. Thank you for all that you've done for me. Thank you for the salvation that I enjoy. Thank you for the wife you give me. Thank you for the friends I have. Thank you for the church that I'm allowed to serve. Thank you, and go on and on. Okay? A-C-T-S, supplication. Supplication is when you pray specifically. And when I begin to pray specifically, I get specific about people. I begin to pray for my family. I pray for them specifically by name. I pray for my wife. I pray for my children. I pray for my grandchildren. I pray for people in our church that's going through whatever it is that they might be going through. That is supplication. You pray specifically. Paul was talking about supplication, okay? And have you ever, you know, you ever taken your infirmity, whatever it is that you're going through, you ever taken it to the Lord and been specific about it? Name it, you know, just whatever it may be. We all can learn from Paul how to pray. Paul prayed definitely, you know. He asked the Lord to take away the thorn in the flesh. Paul prayed earnestly. He pleaded with the Lord. You know, I have no doubt in Paul's life that he probably fasted and wept and begged God to take this thorn in the flesh away. He also prayed persistently. He made his request at least three times, asking the Lord to take it away. Paul's prayer was answered, just not in the way that he expected God to answer his prayer. You know, God answers our prayer either yes, no, or wait. Yes, no, or let's wait a while. I'm trying to do something. You know, it really could that he doesn't always answer our prayers the way we want. Man, there's times in my life I've asked God to do things and I'd go back and look at it and say, God, thank you for not doing that. Thank you for the wisdom that you had. So there's the suffering Paul experienced. There's the supplication Paul made. Third thing is the sufficiency Paul received. I don't know the circumstances of verse 9. I just know that Christ revealed himself to Paul in some way. And with that revelation, he gave Paul, all the believers, the sufficiency of his promise to believe that you can trust in what God says. It was a powerful sufficiency. God gives us a promise found in the Word of God. Let me read something to you. That God is sufficient for whatever it is that you may be dealing with this morning. He says in the book of Isaiah chapter 40, and verse 28. Hast thou not known, hast thou not heard, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary. There is no searching in his understanding. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increases strength. That might be you, might be me. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. Listen to verse 31, though. Isaiah 40, 31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. Paul knew the promises found in the Word of God. Paul knew that he could go to God and trust what the Word of God had to say. And it was also, it was Paul's sufficiency. If you'll notice again in verse number 9 of the personal pronouns that Paul uses, sufficiency, he says, notice, he said, he, me, my, you. Grace is sufficient for you in your need, and grace is sufficient for me in my need. It was also a present sufficiency. The Lord said, my grace is sufficient right now. Not someday, but it is right now. It was already there for Paul to draw upon. All we have to do is to appropriate and to take and receive the experiences to enjoy the grace of God. Sometimes we overlook God's grace. It was a plentiful sufficiency. The Lord said, my grace is more than enough. Listen, church, as the need increases, the grace increases, whatever it may be. The Lord, and this is an important statement, if you don't get nothing else, get this. The Lord won't give us more than we need, sooner than we need, longer than we need. Because if he does, we won't learn to trust him. Let me say that again. God won't give us the grace more than we need, sooner than we need, or longer than we need. And it was a very practical sufficiency that God gave him. The thorn in Paul's life became the channel of the power of God's power in his life. Paul's strength was made perfect in weakness. I read a different version of scripture in this verse 9, and it goes like this. My grace is all you need. My power works best in your weakness. Paul says in verse 9, it really does work. You see, guys, we're not only saved by the grace of God, but I believe a person also lives in victory by the grace of God. I believe with all of my heart, guys, a believer must have grace for the journey of life. For life has to have real meaning and real purpose. You're not going to have that outside the sufficiency of the grace of God in your life, and no matter what it is that you may be going through. Grace changes everything. Right. Let me say that again. Grace of God, the sufficiency, the favor that God gives to you and God gives to me, that grace changes everything. I close with this little humorous story that I got, but it's so true nonetheless. There was a redneck from the hills of Tennessee, saved up a whole lot of money to go on he called it a big boat ride. It was a cruise. He had seen it advertised before. He said, I'm going to go on one of them cruises. So he saved every dime that he possibly could in order to buy the ticket to go on a cruise. But one of the things he didn't understand as he was saving money to go on the cruise, he didn't understand that as he took this cruise, that all of the food would be supplied. So he started making him some peanut butter and jelly sandwiches ahead of time. It was a week-long cruise. So he took a big bag, a brown paper bag, and he filled it full of peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. He was so excited when he got on that big ship, that big boat. He said, I never seen nothing like this in my life. And as the day went along, he was about the second day, this redneck was walking around, and he saw some people walk around with a plate of food in their hand. He didn't understand that. He couldn't figure that out. I mean, in the third day, he was about had all he wanted of peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. So he saw this guy walking with this plate of food back towards the table. He said, "Sir, can I ask you a question?" He said, "Sure." He said, "I don't understand something." He said, "I worked so hard to save my money in order to get on this ship." And he said, "I've been eating peanut butter and jelly sandwiches now for several days. And I see all these people walk around with this food. I don't understand how that worked." And the guy with the plate stared at the man and stared at him and said, "Listen," he said, "you need to understand that the money that you paid for the ticket included all the food." The guy was absolutely amazed that he could do that, that he could have all that food. He didn't understand that. You say, "Preacher, what are you trying to say?" I think there's a lot of Christians today that's eating peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, wondering why they can't enjoy a mega meal from God. You know, they look around at other Christians who seem to be victorious, seem to be on top, and seem to be eating spiritual steak and potatoes, and wonder why they are limited to peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. You're kind of like the man on the cruise ship didn't understand is what far too many Christians don't understand. And that's the principle of God's grace. When you accept Christ as Savior, everything you need is provided. And it's important for us to understand that when Jesus went through heaven and he was seated on the right hand of the Father, all the meals were included in that ticket. All the help is in that ticket. All the enablement is in that ticket. All the strength is in that ticket. We need to learn to leave the peanut butter and jelly sandwiches alone and avail ourselves to the provision that God offers in the ticket. But you need to understand that all that we need in life, no matter what it is that we face, is available to us through the ticket of grace. Nothing else. For by grace are you saved through faith. Preacher, what do you mean by being saved? What am I saved from? Well, you're saved from paying the price for your own sin. You can pay for your own sin if you want to. Or you can put your faith and trust in Christ and what Christ has done for you. For the Bible says, for by grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourselves. You don't need to eat peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. Steak's been made available. Jesus Christ paid the price for you to live by the grace of God and enjoy what God's got for you. But it's left up to you to tap into the grace of God. Just like Paul learned. Anybody learn? Paul did. And you can learn too. Are you trusting Christ by grace? Are you trusting the grace of God to get you through what you're facing right now, the mess that you're in, the trial you're going through, the situation you're facing? Are you trusting God in the midst of it? Father, thank you, Lord, for the grace that's ours for the taking. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness that when you died upon the cross and when we put our faith in your death, burial, and resurrection, that everything that we needed in life was bought and paid for, and we enjoy by the grace of God. But we don't enjoy it in any other way other than by grace. And Lord, it's my prayer this morning for those that might be in this church that don't know the grace of God, never have been saved. If they died today, they're not 100% certain that they'd go to heaven. They may be a member of our church. They may be a visitor. Doesn't make any difference. We need to know that we know Christ is Savior, that we can be saved by the grace of God, but no other way. for Christians here this morning, Lord, in the midst of what they're going through, or in the midst of what they might go through, God, I pray that they'll tap into the grace of God. It's theirs for the taking. And Lord, I pray for folk this morning in this room that will not stop praying for the right pastor for this church, that will come to this altar and beg you, God, give us peace that only you can give. Lord, there may be somebody here that needs a church home. And if that's true, I pray that they would come to me today. Speak with me personally. God, will thank you for what you'll do in the next few minutes. In Christ's name we pray. Amen and amen. Let's stand, would you please?